site guide. Al?
And now it is my honor to introduce Laura Galbreath. She is the director for the SAMHSA-HRSA Center for Integrated Health Solutions, operated by the National Council for Behavioral Health. She manages the overall operations of the center and leads several learning communities and provides consultation to improve screening and referrals to mental health treatment, create structures for collaborative care for shared patients, and increase access to primary care services for persons with mental illness. We thank Laura for being here today to share her thoughts on the big picture regarding healthcare integration, with emphasis on improving access to care, along with a person-centered approach focused on meeting the interrelated needs of the whole person, mind, body, and spirit. So now please join me in welcoming Laura Galbreath.
Thank you. Thanks. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be with you here today. I was thinking recently about planning for when I was coming here, and it's been a while since I've been to Tulsa, and then it made me think about a few other things. I want to show you something. My boarding pass, if you can see this. Since the last time I came here, I would have had to do things very differently. And I realized that in just the last 5, 10, 15 years, how much has changed in our lives. So yesterday, I used this to check into my flight. I used my phone to order a taxi and have the taxi be paid for through my taxi app, or Uber, for those of you that are familiar with Uber. I also then used it, my credit card is on here, I was able to use it to get a magazine, get something to drink, and then I was able to use it for my boarding pass. And oh, by the way, I did watch a TV show on my phone using Wi-Fi on the airplane. So it's just amazing what's happened in the last 10 years. So I want to share with you a couple other things just to kind of, for us to think about that context. So who remembers AOL and dialing up? Hopefully we were going to try to see if we could play for you that sound because it's just so iconic in what we do. So I don't think we're going to be able to play it, but no worries because you all remember it. That sound, it took forever, but then that lovely you've got mail. I remember eventually when my parents, they still were on dial-up and I would go to visit them. It was one way I got to disconnect because I didn't have the patience to wait for the dial-up. So much has changed in how we access information. And actually, I just was reading actually the AOL. There we go. What can I do? We file my nails. All while waiting to connect. Thank you. And of course, then now I'm impatient. I can't wait 3 seconds for my phone to pull up the information. And what I was going to tell you though is that AOL, there are still over 2 million Americans in our country that use AOL in the dial-up format. This other change I want to share with you. How many of you have done this to kind of show a family member, one of your kids, how to save a document? This is one of my favorites if you take back to share with your team. Notice, what is the icon for save and save as? It's a floppy disk. How many of our kids, our young coworkers, people we work with even know what that is? I've actually seen them at craft fairs where people have redesigned them into notepads now. But it's just funny that we still use this very iconic kind of icon for save, and yet there's a whole generation of folks that have never actually seen one or really know what it is. So it's a great thing to play with when you're back tomorrow at work and with your family. So what am I going to share with you today? I really just want to touch on what are some of the kind of forces that are influencing our work around integrated care? You're going to hear, this is an amazing program, by the way. There's some great speakers and content. If your notebooks aren't just filled with ideas and things that could happen, I'd be really surprised. And so I just want to ground us in thinking about what are some of the forces that are at play, and then what are some of the implications when it comes to integrated care. And then I also want to make sure we have time for some discussion. You know, what big questions do you have when you think about integrated care, both for us as individuals, of mind, body, and spirit, as well as for the systems in which we work? So first of all, we know that now 9.3 million more Americans have access to insurance. We know that the uninsured rate has gone down. We know that health spending has slowed. The rate of healthcare spending has slowed, which is huge. And then that roughly more than half the states have sought Medicaid expansion. We know that's a touchy subject, but we know that no matter what, when half our country is kind of doing Medicaid expansion, it's an important thing to consider. The other one is also about, yesterday I saw on the news, our unemployment rate dipped down to below 5%, lowest rate since 2008. So things are happening. Our economy is changing, and certainly in terms of access to healthcare, things are changing. Some places more quickly than others, but overall, people are getting access to care in ways that they had never had before. Services and payment redesign. You know, one of the forces that's driving integrated care and so much of what you're seeing around increased access is this idea that we need to redesign the services, we need to redesign the payment structures that have led to low health outcomes, that have led to high cost in our systems. And so really we are looking at a fundamental focus on containing costs, but also improving quality. You know, it's not one versus the other. There really is, we're not going to have good cost savings unless we save quality. And this idea of high utilizers, and I know some of my friends, they hate that term, and I get it, I do too. It's, we gotta find some other better way. But it's really kind of, the whole purpose is to say, hey, there are folks out there that have some really high complex needs. Mental health, addiction, physical health conditions, lack of social determinants of health and supports, housing. We've got to really identify those folks because they need quality services. They do cost our system care. And so it's important that we address them. And that's why you hear things around high utilizers and especially around this concept of population health. How do we really think about how to target what we're doing for a very defined population, so that we can measure it and see that we improve outcomes and lower cost? So this is kind of one of those things, a force that's really driving a lot of the change that you're seeing. Another big change is experimentation. There's a real appetite to say, okay, if we're gonna redesign, we really wanna know what works. I wanna know what works in rural communities and urban. I wanna know what works for people with mental illness, people with addictions, our minority populations, you know, really how do we experiment both in terms of the design and the finance of integrated care? And this bubble, it's really just for you to see the number of innovation projects coming out of CMS, just to give you a sense of kind of the scale of how much experimentation is going on. And while that's a kind of a scary change, it's really an exciting opportunity. You know, wow, we get to actually have some evidence about what works. We get to focus on the needs of folks that have been very disfranchised from access to healthcare. We really get to look at lots of different models. And obviously in Oklahoma, you guys are working on Medicaid health homes. You know, what are we gonna learn about how Medicaid health homes are developed here that's gonna inform how care is served to all folks in the state, as well as other states across the country? So just there's a real opportunity in that experimentation. But what I want to also mention is that what's underlining a lot of this? If you look in each of those little bubbles, what's kind of a common factor? care coordination. You know, it's really that underlying underpinning of kind of what we see in so many of the changes. How do we better connect people to the services that they need? It can be really complex, it can be overwhelming. How are we sharing information? And I know some of you, what I hear sometimes from folks in the mental health community is, well, we're great at care coordination. We're right, we do some amazing work in terms of really connecting people and working with them one-on-one. How do we scale that up to an entire community? How do we bring that to the people that we serve who have serious mental illness and that we're trying to keep into the community? But how do we also bring that skill set of care coordination to the broader population of folks that need some coordination of care? Also thinking about long-term supports. I mean, lots of things, really this underpinning of care coordination. So it's really important that we think about, as a driver and a force of change, what does that look like, and how do we help define our role in care coordination? So something to think about as an element. What's another force of change kind of impacting our work around integrated care? Technology. I shared with you, obviously, you know, kind of what's changed in our life, but even in healthcare. If we've got, you know, millions more people now access to healthcare, we also have 2 in 5 households rely on a cell phone as their only means of phone communication. I think the third bullet is really important for us, because a lot of times we think that folks in the, you know, underserved Medicaid population don't always have access to technology. And yes, there is a definite digital divide, but that divide is actually shrinking. 72% of individuals with serious mental illness own a medical device, according to a Dartmouth study that they did. Now, it may not be a smartphone, but it is a cell phone, and they're using that cell phone. And this is one category, 30 category of apps used to diagnose autism, Down syndrome, and other special needs. That doesn't even touch the number of apps that are being developed to manage our mental health, let alone our physical health. Think about ones that you're maybe doing around meditation apps. What are we doing to measure what we ate today? How many steps we had? How are we doing on meeting our health goals compared to our friends and mapping our runs? It's really just in terms of something that's a force that's going to impact how we do integrated care. It's something we cannot deny. And then thinking about some progress that we've made. You know, we've made a lot of great progress in getting people access to care. But we know that among the 10 leading causes of death, only one, suicide, continues to go up. So we're doing really well in a lot of areas, but in others, we're really still failing our communities. And yesterday, I was just hearing one of your board members, Kelly, was wonderful enough to pick me up from the airport, and we were talking, and she was sharing with me the story of the gentleman who just recently jumped to his death, and that, you know, there was a missed opportunity, or there was an opportunity, but what went wrong around the fact that he had met with his doctor literally hours before committing suicide? What can we learn from that? What are opportunities for us? And we know that in terms of the science, the brain, I think you've got some great presenters here that are going to talk about what are we learning from a science perspective that can educate and inform the actual delivery of care. And recognizing that still 6 out of 10 folks get no mental health care. So even though we may have access, you know, they're not getting there, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. And recognizing, of course, that 30 million folks get their prescription medications for psychiatric medications in primary care setting. So again, that care coordination, how are we making sure that people don't just get a prescription, they're getting the therapies that they need, the social supports, other services. And often, you know, we talk about mental health, but what about the role of addictions? The CDC is actually officially calling the opioid drug abuse problem an epidemic. They're using that word. We know that over a third of all folks that are trying drugs for the first time are trying them from a prescription. So they're not, you know, going out and buying, but we know that they're quickly evolving to things like heroin because of cost. So when we talk about integration, you know, we often, like, well, in the primary care, we'll talk about depression or anxiety, but we need to quickly be thinking about also then, what about addictions? What about folks and their alcohol use? What about prescription drug, pain, pain management? Number one topic that we've been asked to do in terms of webinars for next year when we polled folks is pain management. What do I do to support people and how do I handle that? So another kind of force to be thinking about is our workforce. I mean, how many of you have struggled to find and recruit good folks to work in integrated settings or into the work that you're doing in healthcare? We are moving to a service economy. You know, so much of the things that we buy are manufactured elsewhere, but we pay more for good services. And certainly in the healthcare, we have to really, and especially in mental health, think about what does that mean in terms of recruiting good folks that are skilled and passionate about the work that they do. But we can't undermine the value of money. In an analysis we did just in the last couple of years, a case manager working at a residential facility was making about the same as an assistant manager at a fast food restaurant. You know, we've got to talk about the workforce needs. If we want good quality outcomes, if we want to reduce cost, we need, you know, folks that are trained, skilled, and well compensated so that they can stay engaged and provide the outcomes that we're looking for. So it's just something, you know, again, another force that we need to be thinking about, especially as I mentioned earlier with a 5% unemployment and going down, what does that change in terms of our role and the forces that impact integrated care? So limited access, I've kind of alluded to this, that two-thirds of primary care visits report poor access to mental health care for their patients. They have trouble getting into specialty services. And maybe if somebody has insurance, being able to get into a private practitioner can be on average 25 days. So what does that lead us to? We have untreated mental health problems in primary care. But then we also have untreated medical conditions in specialty care. So, you know, it really begs, we've got a lot of great opportunity to really make some positive outcomes, given that there's this excitement for experimentation. What's our individual role in that experimentation? And so let's dive in a little bit there and think about practice change. And, you know, everyone wants better change, but nobody necessarily wants that change. So I'd like for you to do something for me right now. So if you could cross your arms in front of yourselves. Thank you, I can see most of you. this is very natural, you didn't even have to think about it, it's just something we do. How many of you have your right arm just looking? Is your right arm in front or is it your left arm? So we've got a mix. Okay, now do me a favor, switch which arm is on top. That took a couple of seconds, didn't it? It's like, wait, right arm under, yeah. You know, something as simple as switching our arms to make that change. It feels kind of uncomfortable in our stomachs, you know, like, wait, that doesn't feel natural. That doesn't feel right. And so we think about change and what we're trying to do, you know, we've got to take it down to little bite sizes so that we can really think about what we can do tomorrow and not get overwhelmed by the big changes. And by the way, I see some of you have already uncrossed your arms, even though I didn't say anything about uncrossing your arms. So making change stick is a challenge. So maybe you can get somebody to do something a little bit different, but then actually being able to keep that and maintain that takes attention. So let's talk about behavioral health. One of the big things I think is just kind of fundamental is just, do we understand what behavioral health means? You know, for us, for folks in the mental health and addictions community, we think of behavioral health as a catch-all term for mental illness and addictions, for actual diagnosable conditions. I've been with folks on the medical side that are like behavioral health. Those are the behaviors that impact health. So somebody's compliant, somebody's smoking, somebody's taking their medication every day like their treatment plan calls for. It's those behaviors that impact health. And reality is it really kind of could be a catch-all for all, but we have to be able to, if we're having these conversations about integrated care, make sure that we're all on the same page. Because say you're a mental health center and you've now brought in a nurse or a primary care, or you're meeting with some primary care partners in your community, and it's all of a sudden you're realizing that you're not on the same page. So we've got to be on the same page. We've got to have that same language. Same thing when we talk about integration. You know, how are we defining integrated care? And by the way, you see a link down here on the website. You don't have to take many notes because I created a whole resource sheet for you that's going to have hyperlinks to all of these resources. And oh, by the way, I have not been compensated. I am clear of conflict, by the way. I forgot to mention that earlier. There's no conflict with me being here. But again, are we on the same page? So let's dive into this definition a little bit. Care that a patient experiences. So integration is about that patient experience. It's not just about the larger system. That results as a result of a team. Well, what does that team look like? You know, it changes based on the needs of your community, what available resources you have, but certainly there's validity and evidence around what a team looks like. And it's of primary care and behavioral health clinicians. So we think about really, wow, this is a new team. I haven't necessarily worked with them before. We refer, but am I actually working together? And we can never forget that it's working together with the patient and families. None of this can be achieved if the patient and the family is not front and center. It's their treatment plan. It's their health. It's, you know, they're the ones that are going to leave the clinic, the facility, the hospital, and go home and try to implement changes to improve their health and to support their recovery. So we can never forget that. And then a systematic and cost-effective approach. So what are those evidence-based practices? Systematic, how am I making our everyday routine of how somebody gets care just like this, and not like this awkward trying to switch? You know, so thinking about what's that system? Like, what's my clinical workflow? Or what I like to say is, what's my daily routine? You know, I get up, I go to work. How am I changing that daily routine so that people get access to integrated care? And then obviously cost effective. And then, again, patient-centered and for a defined population. You know, so how are we really looking at data and information to make a difference? And this is a great photo of a team huddle. This is a medical group, and obviously on the left we've got, there's two Kellys that are nurse practitioners working with the physician, one care coordinator, and a behavioral health specialist. And so they have morning huddles to talk about the folks that are coming into that clinic that day and how can we think about their treatment plan. And the role of the behavioralist is just huge in having that team approach and working together. This very easily could be an embedded clinic at a behavioral health site. So it could be a clinic embedded as a residential treatment facility. You know, as long as we're working together as a team, working to kind of address needs, prepare, those huddles are critical. But obviously we have to find time and money to support folks to be able to have those important conversations for good care. So I want to talk a little bit just about, you know, bi-directional integration. We talk about bi-directional, again, another point of language is around, we talk about behavioral health and primary care. So how are we embedding mental health and addiction treatment services into a primary care setting? Bi-directionally, for folks that are receiving mental health and addiction services, how are they getting access to, you know, needed health prevention, wellness, and services and connection to specialty. So we really want to think about that holistic picture bi-directionally. So I want to talk a little bit about primary care and kind of some of the things and implications that these different forces are having and why we need to make sure that behavioral health is part of primary care. You know, it's been amazing. It was really not that long ago when we had a meeting, it's probably 5 years ago, with a very important, powerful physicians group in Washington, D.C. And I came in with all my stats. I was ready to talk about the prevalence of behavioral health problems in primary care and why they needed to focus on integration. We walk in, I start with my stats, I'm ready. They're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And I'm like, oh God, what's happening? They're like, we get it. We know that we need to be doing this. Our challenge is, we don't know how. How do we start? We know we have to do this. How do we pay for it? How do I get my physicians trained? What kind of staffing do I need? What's the treatment protocol that people have? So it's amazing that there is that philosophical understanding that's growing around the prevalence. We know that there are unmet needs. So we know that there's a prevalence of, you know, connection. Nowadays, folks coming out of having a heart attack are typically maybe prescribed an antidepressant because we know the comorbidity in terms of depression after a major heart attack. But what does that look like in terms of the support, the patient education? Lots of questions there. But we know that there are unmet behavioral health needs. How many folks are coming in for a physical health symptom and maybe it's something underlying that could have been addressed? And so I'm gonna move forward. I just wanna share a story about that. This is a video you can find online. It's Integrated Primary Care Discovers Mental Health Lessons Early On. This is Larissa. She went to a regular checkup for her pediatrician. They now do universal screening, so every adolescent and child that comes in gets screened for behavioral health issues and behavioral challenges. A psychologist is embedded as part of that clinic, and that's who Larissa, her mother, are meeting with, is the psychologist. They were able to identify that Larissa was having some really serious anxiety issues, some real challenges around when she had to meet those test scores, but right then and there, they were able to address it. This story goes on to talk about how the psychologist even uses a reference to finding Elmo, and how the character is like, just breathe, just breathe. So, you know, being able to help Larissa now, before her anxiety gets so bad that she's failing out of her classes, she's avoiding classes, you know, this is a powerful opportunity for us to stop, you know, that trajectory of what can happen to somebody who experiences a mental illness or an addiction. You know, how can we catch that alcohol use before it gets to the point of somebody hurting themselves, their family, losing a job? I mean, we know those stories. So I think when I talk to some consumers and consumer groups that are really concerned around the medical model and that we're just gonna go back and we're gonna lose everything that we've achieved in recovery, I'm like, we do have a responsibility to talk about what recovery looks like and to help our broader field understand what that means and what's involved in that. But that doesn't mean that we don't do integration, that we don't focus on what we can do early on so that folks aren't disabled and their lives destroyed by illness. So I think it's a great story. I'm happy to send a link for those that would like to use it, because I think videos are a wonderful way to tell stories, especially as we engage with folks that are just learning about all of this. Okay, so lower cost, obviously, better health outcomes. I think it's also important about satisfaction. There are some great studies out there now and some stories, videos, quotes, I mean, you name it, of folks that are just really satisfied with this integrated care. Be it a patient who doesn't even know that they're in an integrated setting, all they know is that there's somebody there helping them with what they're feeling challenged with or suffering with. But for physicians, it's like, wow, I was scared to ask about depression. Now I know I've got somebody I can bring in and provide some support. I now have a psychiatrist that I can consult with because there's a patient here I could be helpful to, but I need a little bit more information and support. So I think it's really important to not just think about, you know, yes, you know, we have to do this because change is happening, but also because it makes everybody more satisfied and happy with the work that we do. So let's talk about the specialty behavioral health community. So this slide I think is really interesting because we talk about accept and adapt. I actually used to work for the Mental Health Association of Georgia. back in the day. And I remember going and doing a scrap, going to one of the sites kind of in southeast Georgia. Been around for at least 50 to 60 years. I mean, one of the oldest MHAs down in that area. And they were so proud, they showed me the scrapbook. And it used to be that the Mental Health Association advocates at that time, one of their big events was to bring food and clothing and host a party for consumers at the psychiatric hospital. So it was people, you know, being nice to those folks that are locked away at a hospital. You know, boy, how we have changed. You know, 1963, we passed the Community Mental Health Act, where we really focused on getting folks out and developing community-based services. That's not that long ago. And then now, where are we headed? Where behavioral health, mental health, addictions, all the things that involve our health are truly integrated. And so I think it's an exciting time for our field, but we can't forget to look back to see how far we've come. And I think the co-occurrence of mental illness and other chronic conditions cannot be said enough. You know, you don't have to have all the details here, but you can see the red line is if you have a mental illness, your co-occurrence, be it high blood pressure, smoking, heart disease, is extremely higher, and in terms of your need. So we know that even if an adolescent is presenting us to ourselves and they seem relatively healthy, they don't have a chronic condition, doesn't mean it's not time to start thinking about and engaging around their health and wellness. It was really interesting, actually, some of the PBHCI grantees that SAMHSA funds, we had a meeting with one of the newer ones, and they thought that they could only enroll people into this health and wellness program if they were folks that already had a diagnosable illness. And we were like, no, you know, part of this is we want to make sure that just like we're asking primary care to screen every single patient coming in for mental health, we want, and addictions, we want to make sure that every single person coming into our specialty mental health and addictions treatment is looked at their health. Are we taking blood pressures and doing basic health screens? Are we coordinating with their primary care doctor? Or if they don't have a primary care doctor, how are we providing services? You know, one of the things, if you're doing integration, we talk about is the fact that if you're a behavioral health provider, a lot of times maybe we ask, do you have a primary care doctor? You know, and folks may because of insurance or have somebody that they know. The second and most important question, when's the last time you saw that doctor? On average, we're hearing about 5 years since folks saw their last physician. And we can understand. I mean, when you don't have stable housing, you know, when you're trying to stay out of a hospital or jail because of your symptoms and what's going on in your life, but we want to make sure that we catch people at that wonderful, unique opportunity to meet them where they are and really talk about their whole health, their mind, their body, and their spirit. And so for specialty care, I think one of the things that we're seeing the implications is that specialty organizations are going to be delivering whole health care to populations with complex conditions. So this means, you know, it's going to be a one-stop shop. Folks are going to be coming in, getting all the services that they need. Maybe that case manager is coming out to them at their home, and they're not just focused on maybe their employment supports. They're going to be thinking about their health and how are you supporting them in their health goal. That we're really looking at somebody in that full picture. But then also there's a role for specialty inside of medical homes, health homes, ACOs. You know, we bring such wonderful expertise around that care coordination. Or think about those of you that are trained in motivational interviewing. Is motivational interviewing just for something that we use in the mental health community, or could it be used to impact those health behaviors, to help somebody better manage their diabetes, to help somebody who's trying to lose, you know, just 5 or 10 pounds? How can we support folks and bring our expertise? So I think, it's that opportunity, that experimentation that we're seeing that's so exciting. And I think it's transforming organizations. And I think one of the great ones that I just want to share with you is Asian Counseling Referral Service. They're one of the earlier cohorts of behavioral health providers that received funding from SAMHSA to integrate care. And what I really like is that they went through a complete paradigm shift. You know, it wasn't like, okay, this is the trend du jour, and now we're going to do integration, and we're going to have this clinic over here, and, you know, we'll refer people to that clinic. They've completely changed how they do business, from transforming to a mental health services model to a wellness service, mind and body working together. Their daily activities all have to include a wellness programming component. Exercise, movement, and dance are part of every single group activity. So they didn't create just a group for people to manage their diabetes or a group to, you know, eat healthy. They've just embedded it in every single thing that they're currently doing. And what does that look like for you if you're an HR person? If you're sitting here, I'm like, well, I'm not a clinical. You know, I don't do clinical. I do HR. That means, how do we make sure our job descriptions are reflective of the environment that we want and that people are going to be working in integrated care? That staff are getting cross-training, that I'm taking that nurse that's over here and training our case managers on what is a hemoglobin A1C? What is a high blood pressure number I need to know about? And how do we orient our new staff and think about our branding and all of that? So really kind of thinking about your role in integration, no matter where you sit, is huge in impacting this transformation and helping that we have that paradigm shift. And really, it does take, I like this slide because it helps me to think that it takes some shifting of our mental model. It takes that actual effort of thinking, okay, I'm going to do this now. How am I going to do this? You know, it takes that 2 seconds or that 10 minutes or that longer-term strategy for us to think as individuals as well as systems around how are we going to change to integration to meet outcomes. So what are some ways in which we can think about that? Changing our mindset. Well, one is, who are we talking to? Are we just talking to people that we're familiar with, talk a different language with unfamiliar colleagues? Are we talking cow when we really want to be talking cat? I mean, I think it's really important is, you know, we need to have those conversations. Early on, when folks were really just starting integration, they'd say, well, what do? I really want to partner with the health clinic. I'm a mental health clinic. You know, I'm not sure, what do I do? We would say, have you taken them out for coffee? Have you talked about your shared pains? What keeps you up at night? So being able to talk to different folks, and not just primary care. We have hospital systems that are so in the middle of transformation that they are struggling around what to do. They want and need our engagement now more than ever. What about our public health officials that are working on tobacco cessation, obesity awareness? What's that opportunity to have a conversation about, hey, we have some wonderful folks over here that could really benefit from that community program? And then always starting with the question of, what can I help you with? I had one behavioral health provider organization, and we were chatting, and she's like, you know, I want to partner. I said, well, why do you want to partner? What is it you want to get? They're like, well, I want access to their payments that they get, the extra money that they get. I was like, that is not the way to go into a partnership. You know, that is the hopeful that maybe one day after years or of working together and having a really strong partnership that might be achievable. But you go in based on what's the needs of our community, what's the needs of our population, how can I support you and you support me? So really having that different conversation. And I think being clear that understanding that all care will be managed, if we look at that bubble of all that experimentation, a lot of that is saying that if we're going to have better care coordination, we have to think about how are we bundling payments? How are we coordinating that care through an electronic medical record that can talk to one another in our community? And actually, when I was on the CMS's website, I noticed that in terms of their bundled payment, there's over 83 providers, hospitals or otherwise, in Oklahoma that are part of a bundled payment innovation. So you already have folks that are experimenting with integration, care coordination, and these kind of new financing models. How do we connect with them and engage with them to really learn, understand, and help shape it so that it's recovery-oriented? It really does focus on the mind, body, and the spirit. And related to that, what's our role in delivering world-class customer service? You know, now that more folks have insurance, or will have insurance or access to care in whatever shape that forms, you know, people are gonna have a choice. They're gonna have more choice about where they go to get services. So how do we make sure that people get that kind of world-class customer service, that it is patient-oriented? What's your goal? What do you want to achieve here today? Also, how do we make sure to market and brand ourselves? You know, we've been so siloed in the behavioral health field. You know, maybe people know us because, oh, well, you drive by there, that's the place where people go, you know, all the stigma involved. But, you know, as we become more ingrained in the community, what's our marketing? What's your presence on Facebook? You know, do you talk about integration? Do you share stories? You know, so thinking about customer service, branding, is gonna be so critical for our field. And then implementing measurement-based care. This isn't, for any case managers out there, I promise you, this isn't about adding more data that you need to collect. It's not saying, okay, great, we're doing integration, now I've got 10 more things I need to collect. It's about collecting the right information, so looking and saying, okay, what do we need to get rid of? Maybe that's not necessarily. But then also, what's the trajectory? How do we know somebody is getting better? You know, how do I know that somebody's health is improvement? What's a dashboard? You know, I think about the apps I use. It really helps when I can see, oh, wow, I have been consistent, or boy, I did lose 3 pounds. I should be really proud of that. You know, so how are we using data to inform quality care and financing and everything that we do? So, for example, you know, if we don't measure it, as you can see, we can't manage it, we can't improve it, and ultimately we won't be paid for it. And I think one of the paradigm shifts that it's been exciting for us in the behavioral health field is the fact that folks are collecting data, they're creating these amazing dashboards to give to an individual, but they're also able to show their colleagues that, hey, look, we've been providing a wellness program for this, you know, cohort of 50 individuals. Look how we've been able to improve their health. You know, 50% of them improved their blood pressure, lowered their blood pressure. Two-thirds of them lost, you know, 2 pounds. You know, being able to tell that story, not just as the individual client level, but at the population level. And then being able to translate that into cost savings is gonna be key. So, you know, it's not just about having more data and entering more information, it's about how we use it, how we share it, and how we communicate it. And then that ties specifically into the workforce. I've talked about training, you know, cross-training. How do we help folks prepare? Smoke-free campuses. It's not just an issue for the clients that we're serving. How many of us as employees smoke? How many of us as employees need access to wellness services and interventions? So it's an important picture in terms of preparing the workforce. We just had a really interesting discussion at the center about concurrent documentation. Folks were so upset by the fact that they were being asked to have a laptop and to record the notes with the patient or a consumer while it was occurring, that they wrote a formal letter saying, there was like 4 or 5 of them, they went to a restaurant after work and sat there and wrote out this letter worried and complaining that they're gonna reduce the quality in terms of their care. And the reality is, if you actually ask individuals about concurrent documentation, so the people being served, they actually prefer it. They actually like the fact, the data that we've seen, that I'm having a conversation, I get to know what you're recording, I get to have a say in whether or not I agree with that or what that treatment plan is gonna look like. So I think, you know, how do we help people prepare for that? And certainly around technology, really technology-rich services. And that's really where we're gonna be thinking about how does it help supplement what you do? Meaningful use, how many of you are in the process of dealing with electronic medical records of some phase or sort? I see some hands. You know, meaningful use does require that we ask patient what's their preference for how we communicate with them. How many of us text? You know, we get text reminder to go to the dentist or my hairdresser texts me. but why aren't I don't get a text reminder about my appointment to see my psychiatrist? Of course, we have to think about how we do that in a way that's confidential, but we have to be thinking about if all of our clients are moving more and more to having cell phones, how are we using that as a way to communicate? And there's some great information out there and tools to support us how we do what I like, what I've heard called technology-rich services to support care coordination, transparency, and really not so much in my mind to replace, but to extend staff. You know, what could be done with technology? Think about the devices that you can embed in somebody's in their home to help track and support their care coordination so you're not constantly there all the time. So there's some great tools. And all of this has to be thought about in terms of how are we communicating for success? And you know, if you haven't heard it, this is kind of a big common term when you think about some of the folks that are at that system level, the IHI's triple aim. How are we improving outcomes, lowering costs, and improving the quality and the consumer experience? That's the story we have to tell. We have to tell that threefold story. It's not just the data, but it is also making sure that we have good evidence-based practices and that people are getting better and that we're able to measure that and be able to show that for this population of folks that we intervened, we were able to keep them out of the emergency room and improve their health. And so I really just think there's such great opportunity. There's so much great innovation already going on out there. We just may not mean to think about how we communicate it a little bit differently. And then really thinking about leadership. Being fearless but not reckless in the face of change. Adam Bryant is a writer that some of you may know. He did a book. We had a feature him at the conference. He really talks about being passionately curious. So how are we making sure that we're passionately curious about this integration and what we're doing and what the opportunities that it presents themselves? How are we making sure that our teams are put together in a way that really supports them and engages them? And so thinking about that change. So I really want to take a few minutes. We have, I think, some roaming mics. What are some questions and thoughts that you have as you think about integrated care? You know, I've shared with you some of the forces that are happening, be it experimentation, financing, our changes to our workforce, the role of our staff. I think integration is just an amazing opportunity. What are, as you think about coming here for the next several days, are your thoughts around integrated care? And I apologize, I can't see where folks are.
Thank you so much, for Laura, for so many interesting things and a new take on a lot of things we're working with. One of the issues that you mentioned is something that I've not heard in the conversation very much, and that had to do with better pay, basically, for the people working in mental health. I think traditionally we have not seen that as something we could do much about. And would you address that in a little more depth? Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think part of it is knowing how much are we paying? What is that medium salary compared to other medium salaries in our community? Certainly, Oklahoma is going to be very different than salaries paid in New York. But being able to have that information. One of the things I think is really exciting for our field is the concept of community, certified community behavioral health providers. Oklahoma is one of the states that applied for a planning grant, so cross your fingers that you guys get the funding, to really look at what does it mean. This was probably the most powerful legislation that passed congressionally since the 1963 legislation that will allow us to have a standard definition of what are behavioral health providers and services. Because right now we're fractured. How you define mental health services in Oklahoma is completely different than Louisiana or any other place in the country. We need to kind of have that common definition. So you say, okay, great, Laura, we have a common nation. What's it mean around salary? It means that they have to be able to come up with a cost of services. So if we want to be able to pay for behavioral health, we aren't gonna just set a rate that was created, you know, 20 years ago, and maybe if we get lucky, we can increase it by 2% this fiscal year. But what's the true cost of services? So for providers, how are we calculating that true cost to make sure that we've got good salaries for the right staff, who's the right credentialing that we need, and embedded into that cost. So that's one small piece. But I also think the move towards thinking about how we structure staff is going to be task shifting. How do we use the full spectrum that we have available to us so that we can pay folks the right price? So how do we make sure that, you know, yes, we have a psychiatrist, but how do we best use them compared to our nurse practitioners, compared to a peer, and using a peer specialist? So all these things will be factors in making sure that we can create systems that allow for better salaries, better information, and a workforce that's engaged.
Yes. Right here. I had a question. I don't know if you've read Pete Early's book, Crazy, about his son not being able to get treatment and wound up going to jail. He asked the question about the 1963 Community Mental Care Act. When are those services actually going to be provided that the federal government promised those people who were deinstitutionalized? Thank you.
So I'm sorry, can you say a little bit more about your question? Or just rephrase it for me?
It's in regards to the Community Mental Health Care
yes.
Act that you were talking about in 1963.
Correct.
And the fact that the dollars and the services didn't follow the people. So we wound up with transinstitutionalization. His question is, when are those services going to finally be provided?
Exactly. So I think one of the big answers for the moment is the community, certified community behavioral health centers. For us to have a federal definition of what that looks like is going to be key, because then we can support federal funding, state funding. I mean, think about it. How much of mental health services now will be, if we're truly integrated, people will access services through their insurance company if they're part of an exchange. States that are doing Medicaid expansion, you know, with parity, now that funding is going to be coming through there. For folks that aren't doing Medicaid expansion, other initiatives to increase access to services. I mean, we truly are moving away from the day when it will just be purely a block grant from the feds or state financed, that these other mechanisms will have parity. Now, is parity perfect, and do we need a lot of work to make sure that people have a good array of services? Most definitely. So I think we're making strides between federal definitions, between expansion of access to services that now include mental health and addiction treatment, we're making strides to put the money where we need and not making sure that we're siloed.
Yes, I was wondering, in preparing for my presentation this afternoon, I came across a lot of stuff that Great Britain's doing, because they seem to be further advanced out of necessity, I guess, because they have their healthcare system, there's more of a backlog and wait list for services than we have here, and they'd had several suicides while people were waiting. And I noticed that they had a really extensive, their NHS has a really extensive health apps library where they rate and review apps that different people create there. Do we have something like that here? I found like agency specific apps that like SAMHSA had created, or VA and CDC, but I didn't find where there was where they rated and reviewed and apps that were developed by other companies. And I just wondered where we are in regards to that.
That's a great question. I know we're actually waiting for a TIP, which is some treatment guidelines that come out from SAMHSA on apps. One of the leading centers out of Dartmouth on technology, on their website, and I'm happy to, you'll actually have my email address in a minute, happy to send that to you for any of those that are interested, have a nice kind of catalog and are kind of not industry funded. But it is going to be a challenge. You know, the app world, man, that is just changing every day so quickly. How do we keep up to make sure there's validity in terms of, if we're going to offer this as some treatment support, that it's evidence-based, that it helps in terms of a crisis. You know, the worst case scenario is we don't need people using tools that aren't helping them, and they're not getting connected to community services. So, you know, there is not one kind of go-to place at the moment. We see things happening from SAMHSA, we see things happening from the Office of the Coordinator, really our federal kind of guidance around a lot of technology and EHR. So it's developing. So it's a great question we need to continue to press and ask as we use these tools. We can't be afraid to experiment, though. We have to be able to say, okay, you know, we don't have the full blessing of this app, but let's see if we can try to use it. You know, let's experiment. Let's see if this is something our clients would be interested in. We did a technology learning community where we worked with probably about a dozen behavioral health providers that wanted to use an app to support people around their health goals. It was an interesting challenge for them in terms of recruiting consumers, but then also folks knew that it was kind of something new and that we're trying this out. We're gonna say, we wanna see if this app helps you. How can we add this to what we're already doing in terms of integrated services? And so there's some great lessons learned coming from that, but we can't be afraid to try new and different things. And I do wanna mention too, before the next question, you mentioned international. We were just actually having this conversation about the VA, because there are so many great lessons to be learned about what's happening through systems like the Veterans Administration or the Department of Defense or Australia or the UK. You know, just because they're funded differently doesn't mean there are things that we can't learn. But how do we take those kernels or those nuggets of learning from other countries and see how we can embed them in the world in which we live in terms of financing, workforce, and other constraints?
I'm curious about the absence or the presence of patient-centered medical home here in Oklahoma. I worked for 2 years in Wisconsin, and I was the behavioral health specialist seated in a pediatric department. They screened every single patient that came in, 13 or older, and I often saw smaller children that had serious problems. That was such a huge thing to the physicians and a huge thing to the parents, because a lot of times they didn't know where to go. They were bringing them to their pediatrician because they weren't sure where to start. It was a small child or it was an odd problem. But the impact was unbelievable. Instead of children being shipped from place to place, having to go through the emergency room, I could admit them directly under the auspice of the physicians there. Actually, they take a licensed clinician's admission. And that's what I did. And I don't see that here in Oklahoma. I'm not aware of it. And I think that's a very important thing. It provides the physicians with the ability to continue their work for the day and not have people waiting hours to see them. And it provides immediate relief for the families involved.
Definitely. So for those of you that aren't familiar, the patient-centered medical home is kind of it's really where our primary care field is moving in terms of a construct that means that people have a physician, so I'm assigned to an individual physician, that I can have enhanced access, so I'm not waiting 2 weeks to see the doctor, that I can get in earlier if I need. E-prescribing, it's kind of a whole host of guidelines and structures around medical home. And there are criteria now. And so we're seeing that move. So anybody, if there are FQHCs here in Oklahoma, they're all moving towards patient-centered medical home status. It's being required by the federal government. Your health insurance companies here, a lot of them are offering incentive payments for providers to move to patient-centered medical home. But there are a lot of challenges. You know, in some states, you know, they can't pay for a behavioral health professional in the current system to be part of that team. There's no mechanism. So it has to kind of get built into the financing construct. So I'm sure there's some really unique issues around integration here in Oklahoma, and I think over the next 2 days you'll probably hear a lot of those. And how do we then take those to have those conversations and really support change? So I think it's a great opportunity in terms of embedding behavioral health, and we think about integration into this already existing movement called the patient-centered medical home. It aligns perfectly with it. It's just depending on the rate of change and the financing and the other pieces is probably why you're seeing such a difference. And so I think, you know, some states we've worked with, they've put together whole reports that say, well, what are the barriers? You know, is it a credentialing issue? Is it a same-day billing issue for Medicaid patients? Is it issues around even same doors? Up in Massachusetts, they had to have separate waiting rooms. And it was just an old regulation. But they, you know, needed to sit down and have that, figure out what were those challenges and how they could change it. So I want to take one more question, and I'm going to be here for most of the afternoon, so would love to talk to you more if there's anything specifically, but I want to share something with you after this next question.
Hi, Doc. I'm wondering about what you've seen across the United States concerning community-based medicine as a movement. That's something that I know is really taking off in a big way in Tulsa. Something very exciting. What are your thoughts?
Community-based medicine?
Mm-hmm.
So,
certainly an interdisciplinary integrated approach that is centered in the community.
Yeah.
But involves both the private and, you know, public sector.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's kind of getting, I don't hear about it just in that way. I hear about it under an ACO. So we've got an ACO, we want to bring a certain, you know, approach to what we're doing in our community for an accountable care organization. Or we're going through a system change, and our managed care contracts are now going to be required to have kind of a community approach. And then certainly the biggest challenge is around recruitment. You know, how many physicians are becoming family physicians and not going into specialty. So I think it's embedded in some of these bigger things. I'm just not hearing about it specifically as this targeted intervention like what you guys are doing, but I think there's a need in terms of if you guys are doing something really cool, our role at the federal level, be it the National Council, Mental Health America, SAMHSA-HRSA, is to share those innovations because there's such great, exciting innovations going on. And I think, you know, I talked about the triple aim, you know, sharing information about how we're improving quality, cost, and the experience of care. And I think that's going to be critical, but I also know that if you layer with that the power of someone's personal story, it's even more impactful. And so I want to share with a video with you now that we asked behavioral health providers that are funded by SAMHSA, PBHCI, including some grantees here in Oklahoma. We asked that at last year's meeting that people make videos. And these are all homegrown videos, okay? No high production. We said find your most tech-enabled staff person to go out and interview clients around integrated care. And this is one that I want to share with you today.
Okay, so before the PBHCI grant, what prevented you from assessing primary health care?
I don't think I really understood about total health care. It was take care of the problem, and when it's over, it's over. Mm-hmm. I never looked at preventive maintenance at all.
Sure.
And if you compare it to a painter, they're doing the same thing. They're painting to prevent rust. And,
sure. Yeah.
But yeah, to have the trust of a doctor, somebody you kind of hold on a pedestal all your life, and to have somebody you can actually talk to and integrate with is pretty cool. And it never happened to me before.
Her opinion on this.
Right, and she wanted me healthy. If it wasn't for her, I probably wouldn't be here right now. I would have never realized I had pancreatitis.
Sure.
That's what started this whole journey.
Right.
Things I wanted to tell you about was that the food class, the cooking class we took, when they took us to Hy-Vee and showed us how to read labels, and that really, even though I eat not good, at least I'm aware of what I'm doing, and I never was aware of what I was doing before.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Awesome.
The food class helped a lot.
Awesome. Great.
In combination with everything else.
Hold on to me as we go. As we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down.
change is hard. It's hard for these folks trying to do health. It's hard for all of us as we try to improve our health and wellness. And it's hard for our systems. But it's a passion. We know that we can make a difference. And I really ask that over the next 2 days, as you think about changes that you can make, where you work, what you do, and in your community, I want to hear from you. You know, email me when you leave here today or when you leave the conference, and really with one change that you think you're going to be able to implement or one thing that you want to try based on all the great information you heard today. That's my job, is to capture and disseminate and share those best practices and lessons learned. And we're excited to kind of really hear about what's happening in the innovation around integrated care in Oklahoma. So thank you for having me, and enjoy the rest of your symposium.